So in this video, we're going to analyze how water flows downhill through this channel. The amount of water that enters this channel, we're going to hold that constant, so this will be steady flow, but the conditions which it flows through change. As you can see, the slope changes. Therefore, this is called non-uniform flow conditions. Water is going to flow through this sluice gate here at the upstream end of the channel, and then down to a lake here at a set elevation. So our boundary conditions are known elevations here at the sluice gate and then the known elevation of the lake here. The flow rate through the open channel is given to us as 900 CFS. The Manning's N for the concrete of this open channel is given us as 0.012. And this is a rectangular open channel. We want to make this a little bit simple to calculate. So it's a rectangular shape and it has a base width of 14 feet. So the first step to analyzing this channel is to determine the critical depth in the open channel. The critical depth is given here in this equation right here on the spreadsheet. It's Q squared divided by B squared times G and all of that to the 1/3 power. Every time I've got a fraction to a power, I want to type that into Excel in pieces so I know I do it right. So I'm going to start off by B squared times G, the gravitation constant in feet per second squared. Then I'm going to put my Q squared term in there. So Q squared divided by that whole quantity. I'm gonna make sure it does the whole thing. So I'm gonna put a parenthesis around the whole denominator. Okay, and then I want this to be to the 1/3 power. So I put a parenthesis around the whole of that and compute the answer. So my answer here is 5.04 as a critical depth. The next thing is we wanna compute the normal depth in the open channel, in each segment of the open channel. And since each segment slopes change, we need to type that in to our table here to make sure we got the right slopes. Now I showed that previously what the slopes were in each channel, so we have that information to ourselves here handy. 0.001 is the upstreammost segment, 0.003 is next, 0.0005 is the second segment right next to the bottom, and then channel one, segment one, is 0.004, and that's the most downstream point, okay? And for now, we're just going to type in a flow depth of one. Just want to make sure it's a number. Don't put equals one in there. In this case, the flow area is computed using this formula here, By. So equals B times Y. The wetted perimeter is computed as 2Y plus B equals 2 times Y plus B. And then the hydraulic radius is A over P. So this is just equal to area divided by wetted perimeter. So to calculate the flow rate, we use Manning's equation. Manning's equation is given here on the spreadsheet as 1.486 divided by N, that quantity times area, times the hydraulic radius to the 2/3, times the slope of the channel to the 1/2. So I type that in here. And again, I'm going to do that in pieces. So I'm going to say, all right, here is slope to the 1/2. Okay, I did that, and it's only shown at zero because I don't show a whole lot of decimal places. We got R to the 2/3 times S to the 1/2, all right, and then I want this to be area times R to the 2/3 times S to the 1/2, very good. And then the last term we need to add in is the 1.486 divided by N times area times R to the 2/3 times S to the 1/2. I'm just rereading this to make sure I did it right. and you should get something that's around 50 CFS there. So once you've done this, we just want to go back through this formulas and copy and paste them all over like this. You can see there's some problems there. Well, here's the issue. When you have a cell reference that needs to stay put, even though you copy it over, you want to put dollar signs in front of the column and the row to lock that in. So in this case, we have the base width B. We want that to stay put because it doesn't change for every channel. It stays the same, okay? Same thing for the wetted perimeter. Again, that's referencing the base width B here, a cell E2. So I'm just going to hit F4 on my PC, and that's going to put in dollar signs around that. That'll lock it in. And then finally, on the Q, we reference cell E1 for the Mannings N. So I'm going to lock that cell in there and keep it there. So all I got to do now is copy that and paste it down. And now that looks better. The goal is to get this Q here that's calculated to be equal to 900 CFS. So the way we do that is by changing the depth. We change the flow depth a bunch of different times before we can find out where it is. And see, now I've gone too far, so I'm gonna go back halfway. Oh, too far, 7.2. Oh, too far, 7.1. All right, and I'm really close here. 7.09, yeah, that's close right there. So that's not bad, but we can make Excel do this for us using GoalSeq. The way we use GoalSeq, I'm gonna put this back to one just so you can see. The way we use GoalSeq is we go here to the data ribbon, what if analysis, and go GoalSeq. And then the cell we want to be fixed is this cell. All right, we want that to be 900 CFS. And we want to get there by changing the depth there. And then we click OK, and Excel runs through it, 7.09. And you're saying, well, you just got there anyway. Well, Excel will take it out a little bit further, but we only ever report it to the hundredth value when we're doing this in practice. So we'll report depths of flow out to the hundredths of feet, mainly because that's what you can survey to. So we repeat this process for each one of these columns. I'll do this again. I want to set this Q to be 900. So I go to what if analysis, GoalSeq, and then I set cell that value, correct, to 900 by changing the depth. And I hit OK. Excel goes through the process and does it for me. So I'm just going to do that for the rest of these really quick. Okay, so there you have it. This is the normal depth of flow under steady uniform conditions in each one of those different segments. So in other words, what we did was we looked at each one of those slope segments of the channel and assumed that they were completely independent from the rest, no transitions happening between them at all, and we just calculated what is the normal depth in the channel. Okay? Now it's helpful to understand here at this point, what is the difference between a steep channel and a mild channel. And that'll help us organize our calculations later. So a steep channel is one where the normal depth is less than the critical depth. So here in segment number 3 in channel 3, the normal depth is less than the critical depth. So we'll just remind ourselves that that segment is steep. Down here, it happens the same as well, where the normal depth in segment 1 is below the critical depth. Here we call this channel, when the normal depth is greater than the critical depth, is mild. So that in terms of slope, we say steep is a, you know, a steep slope, and then the opposite of steep is mild. So that refers to the slope itself. That's a way to characterize the channel slope there. In general, also, what that means in terms of the water in the channel is that it is the water in a steep slope is often flowing at supercritical flow, and then the water in the mild channel is flowing at subcritical flow. Okay? So once you get to this point, I think you should stop here, double check you've got everything right before continuing on to the next part.